Our next speaker has displayed a unique ability to translate theoretical interests into practical results. He was a national coordinator of the Canadian Student Pugwash Organization when they were investigating the role of science and technology in society. Since then, he has become one of the most influential translational scientists of our era. He is a pioneer in the discovery of netrons, the molecules that guide nerve fibers toward their targets. He's identified mechanisms important for understanding how the human brain forms during normal development. His discoveries have been critical to the study of Alzheimer's disease and nerve regeneration following spinal cord injury. He has been a professor at the University of California, San Francisco, and Stanford University. He was a founder of his own company. He was chief scientific officer at Genentech, and he now leads a major research university. To speak on behalf of Class 2, the Biological Sciences, please welcome the Carson Family Professor in the Laboratory of Brain Development and Repair and President of Rockefeller University, Mark Tessier-Levine.
Well, thank you, President Thier, for that kind introduction. I'm deeply honored to accept induction into the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and to represent my fellow honorees in the biological sciences. I thought the most pressing issues I could discuss today are the wonderful and much needed opportunities to advance human health that lie before us, the challenges that simultaneously threaten our ability to take advantage of them, and the steps I believe must be taken to overcome those obstacles to realize the full potential of science to improve the human condition. Let's start by celebrating the fact that we live in a golden age of biomedical research. The past several decades witnessed a glorious revolution in the life sciences that's created unprecedented opportunities to make rapid progress in understanding, treating, and preventing disease. To give just two examples, today we can sequence an entire human genome for just a few $1,000s. This capability, unimaginable 20 years ago, is enabling us to decipher the genetic basis of normal human variation and of diseases both rare and common. We also now have artificial stem cells that provide unprecedented windows into human biology. In my own field, this technology provides the first non-invasive route to generating human nerve cells from patients with neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's that can be studied in the test tube to understand why these diseased cells die prematurely. Powerful tools like these and the growing body of knowledge they enable have the potential to lead to effective medications for poorly treated diseases. And these opportunities are coming none too soon because the health challenges facing us are immense. It's true we've seen great improvements in health. Mortality from heart disease and stroke has been cut in half in the past 40 years. HIV infection is no longer lethal but manageable. Yet despite these successes, the growing prevalence of illnesses such as antibiotic-resistant infection, diabetes, and neurodegeneration threatens to overwhelm us. As the population ages, the number of people afflicted with Alzheimer's disease in the US is projected to triple by 2050, with costs reaching $1 trillion a year. Without effective therapies, the human suffering and economic toll will be devastating. This is clearly the time to take maximum advantage of the huge opportunities for discovery in biomedicine. Yet instead of redoubling our efforts, we're sliding back. On the government side, funding for biomedical research has been flat for a decade and has lost 20% of its purchasing power due to inflation. Scientists spend more time raising money than doing research, and younger scientists are increasingly discouraged from entering research careers. If both trends continue, we're in danger of wrecking our scientific enterprise, a situation made worse by the current government shutdown. Meanwhile, the private sector's drug discovery efforts are not making adequate progress. Despite important successes, the number of drugs approved annually by regulators has remained flat for decades, yet the cost to make a drug has doubled every 5 years, climbing to over $2 billion, an astonishing amount. High costs result partly from ever-increasing regulatory requirements, but the root problem is in research and development. Companies are now adept at making drugs that modify biological targets, but have a poor record of identifying which targets are best to reduce disease and which patients will benefit most from those drugs. The upshot is that only 1 in 24 expensive drug startup projects lead to a marketed drug, a huge and costly attrition. And many ailments, for instance, most psychiatric diseases, still can't be tackled adequately because we don't yet know their underlying causes. We therefore face a double crisis in generating and in applying knowledge. I believe we can nonetheless succeed provided we deal with key funding and organizational challenges. And in this context, I offer a few prescriptions for progress, some of which echo points made earlier today. First, we must, of course, continue to work to reverse the decline in public investment in basic research. From my years in the private sector, I can say from experience that industry builds its applications on the fundamental discoveries made in academia. You can't apply what you don't know, and history has shown that truly transformative knowledge comes from curiosity-driven research. Second, we must simultaneously encourage and facilitate public-private interactions. For instance, for new therapies, insights from academia are already helping industry do a dramatically better job of target selection and patient selection, keys to reducing attrition and containing costs. At the same time, while academia must engage with industry, it shouldn't be asked to do industry's job. There's a trend in the highest reaches of government towards favoring applied research, as this will help secure public support. But if resources are constrained, as they are, and if something has to give, it should be the public investment in applied rather than basic research. The reason is simple. There are alternate funding sources for applied research: industry, disease foundations, philanthropists. But there's only one significant source for basic research, namely government. Industry cannot and will not fund it. We must make the perhaps unpopular case that the greatest gains will come if the public sector supports basic research and industry applies it, with both working hand in glove to translate research results. We must also draw on all disciplines, not just biomedicine, the physical sciences for powerful imaging technologies, as we've just heard, the social sciences to understand and encourage behavior that supports good health, the arts and humanities to nourish patients' souls, all of which are essential to well-being. And finally, we must free up sufficient resources so brilliant young scientists can launch their careers, even if this constrains senior scientists like those of us here today. If we don't, the younger generation will continue to drift towards other professions to the detriment of all. If we have the discipline to tackle these challenges, the future can be bright. And so it behooves all here today, individuals of great talent, accomplishment, and influence, to continue to exercise leadership to make that bright future ours. Thank you very much.